Hello, you're very welcome to this special online briefing for shop stewards on the proposals contained within the Public Service Agreement 2024 to 2026. My name is Aideen Carberry. I'm the Communications Officer for SIPTU's Health Division, and I'll be moderating the briefing today. Today we're joined by three guest speakers who'll be going through the proposals contained within the document in detail. Speaking first, we'll have SIPTU's Deputy General Secretary for the Public Service and Secretary of the Public Services Committee of Congress, John King. John was one of the chief negotiators of the proposals that were brokered with the government last month, and he'll be giving us an overview of the proposals and the context in which they were negotiated. We're also going to be joined by Karen O'Loughlin, who's Divisional Organiser for the Public Administration and Community Division of SIPTU, and Kevin Figgis, who's the Divisional Organiser for SIPTU's Health Division. Both Karen and Kevin will be highlighting some of the key areas of the proposals and how they impact members in both divisions. And they'll also be on hand to answer any specific questions people might have pertaining to the agreement. Before we go to our speakers, we're just going to go over some housekeeping for today's webinar. You might have noticed that the mics and cameras for today's briefing have been disabled for viewers. There's a couple of reasons for this. One is that it can be quite difficult to manage a webinar with a lot of people on it. We've had nearly 500 people register for the event, which is great for a Friday afternoon. And we obviously wanted to make sure that all viewers will get the most that they possibly can out of the session. And that would be difficult to do if we were getting constant interruptions by microphones and all the rest of it. And secondly, the hope is that we're going to record the webinar to make it available to members over the coming days. And we didn't want members who weren't comfortable being recorded to feel under pressure. You'll also note that in the notices for the webinar that we advise people that they could submit any questions that they might have to an email address. That email address was publicserviceballot@siptu.ie. We've already had plenty of questions submitted via this forum. But if over the course of the briefing you feel that there's a question that hasn't been answered by any of the presenters, you can submit them in real time using the Q&A function, which should be up the top of your screen there. We'll be endeavouring to respond to as many questions as possible. But obviously, if we can't answer any question directly over the course of the webinar, because it is scheduled to finish at 2 o'clock, we'll endeavour to respond to those members directly, giving them the information. And don't forget that over the coming weeks, your SIPTU organisers will also be arranging on-site briefings for the ballot to obviously assist in bringing the information to your members and making the proposals clear. So with all that out of the way now, I'll move over to SIPTU Deputy General Secretary for the Public Services, John King, who will take us through the proposals and explain the context in which they were negotiated. Over to you, John.
So good afternoon, colleagues, sisters and brothers. You're very welcome. I'm going to take you through a presentation that was largely in the format that was presented to the National Executive Council of SIPTU at a special meeting held last week, a couple of days following the negotiations. As you'll all be aware, the previous agreement building momentum expired on the 31st of December. We had a number of consultation exercises over 2023 at the AGM and in surveys and so on to make sure that we got a sense of what the key priorities were for SIPTU members. We had a long protracted period of negotiations, really stretching back since around October of last year on the proposals for a new agreement, but it is really fair to say that really only got down to the business end of the agreement in January of 2024. And I'm going to go through those proposals with you. And I'll give a little bit of a context of some of the economics around the agreement. And then we'll have a little look at what happened over the last couple of years with pay and inflation, and also why it's necessary to look at it in the context of the last couple of years. So the outcome to the negotiations have emanated with a set of proposals for a public service agreement to run from the 1st of January 2024 until the 30th of June 2026. SIPTU, we really had four or five key priorities entering into those talks. One obviously was the issue with pay, because we do know the impact that the inflationary and cost of living crisis was having on workers and their families. We also knew that the piece in relation to, we had a big issue in relation to the industrial relations processes and procedures, and I suppose the influence of the Department of Public Expenditure on that. So we did want to try to arrive at a situation whereby we could normalize industrial relations within the public service. We did know that there were increasingly demand for measures to stabilize the agreement. The impact of the no cost increase in claims clauses over the last number of years have resulted in a lot of unrest, disquiet amongst members that they can't get their own local issues dealt with. We did want to then have some conversations and try to see could we get a better understanding in relation to issues around outsourcing and particularly insourcing, and I'll touch on some of them. And there were a significant number of current and outstanding issues that weren't being addressed satisfactorily by the government side. And the agreement provides the means by which we can remain in process with a view to trying to close out on them. And then quite obviously, as is the case in all agreements, there are issues around the public transformation and what we would consider to be the government reform agenda. Now, it's interesting, and it is important to say this, that whilst there is a transformation and a government reform agenda, in relation to any matters that may be covered there, normal industrial relations rules apply. So there has to be consultation, there has to be engagement, and there has to be agreement. And if we can't agree it locally, well, then it will find its way into the Workplace Relations Commission and onto the Labour Court, and so on. And in relation to the normalisation of industrial relations, we did manage to succeed in restoring the primacy of the Labour Court and the Workplace Relations Commission as being the institutions of last resort when there is a dispute between members and their employers. And that's a key piece, and hopefully will be a key piece for us going forward. Just in terms of what the pay increases are, just to skip through them, you're probably familiar with it. But essentially speaking, the agreement provides for a 10.25% increase. I'm going to show the impact of that on pay a little bit later on. So with effect from the 1st of January 2024, there's a 2.25% pay increase, or a flat rate payment of €1,125, whichever is the greater. With effect from the 1st of June 2024, there's a 1% increase. With effect from the 1st of October of 2024, there's a 1% increase, or €500, whichever is the greater. With effect from the 1st of March 2025, there's a 2% increase, or €1,000 flat rate payment, whichever is the greater. With effect from the 1st of August of 2025, there's a 1% payment. With effect from the 1st of September 2025, there's a 1% payment, and that relates to the local bargaining clause. And I'll talk about that specifically in a moment. And then with effect from the 1st of February 2026, there's a 1% or €500 flat rate payment, whichever is the greater. And then with effect from the 1st of June of 2026, there is a 1% payment. And that equals in totals 10.25%. But as I mentioned, I'm going to show a slide in a minute which will show the impact of those percentage increases on scales and rates of pay. In terms of the local bargaining piece, so the local bargaining piece, just to say, is not the same concept as the sectoral bargaining element as to what was contained within Building Momentum, which was specifically designed towards dealing or providing a means to deal with some outstanding issues. This local bargaining clause is going to be future related, and is going to enable workers and unions to be able to progress claims, to be able to deal with grievances that our members have. The clause, we haven't had a local bargaining clause of this nature since about 2006 or 2007 under the PCW of the old national wage agreements. But for the period since 2010 of the public service agreements, there have been no provision for any cost increase in claims other than what was provided within the minimum pay terms of the agreement. So it's 3% of pensionable pay costs. It may include changes in structures, work practices, or other conditions of service that can be negotiated between unions and the sector employers. The plan is, or the intent is, that if the proposals are accepted, the bargaining units or the grades and so on will be agreed between the unions at sectoral level and our sectoral employers. So we all have some understanding of that by the 30th of June of 2024. Right across the public service, it will be intended that negotiations will commence and will be provided with the opportunity to conclude by June of 2025. If no agreement can be reached, the parties will use the WRC and the Labour Court as the means of resolving that dispute. 1% of that 3% is due to be paid with effect from the 1st of September of 2025. The remaining 2% is to be negotiated and will be implemented during the early stages of any successor agreement that will be negotiated to this current agreement. So when I go back to the previous slide, just to show that 1%, so that 1% that's due, that I have asterisked, that's due with the 1st of September of 2025, we have to go and make sure that we do our business at local level to secure that money, to secure that agreement for our members. It is there, the money will be set aside, and it will be paid for by government when we have the agreements concluded. That will present us with an opportunity to engage with members around pursuing issues, around pursuing claims in a way in which we haven't been able to do in the past. So that's going to be an interesting time for us as we go forward beyond June of this year. In terms of the outsourcing piece, so I mentioned the concept of future-proofing, how do we go about ensuring that public services are provided by directly employed public servants? It's probably fair to say that we didn't make the level of progress in relation to insourcing that we would have desired. People will know from in the past, and this time was no different. The government side wants to weaken the outsourcing provisions as they currently are. And this was one of the last elements that we had to make sure that we secured before we were able to say we felt that we had a set of proposals that were worthy of consideration. So we have managed to hold on to the outsourcing provisions, and we have a piece of work that if we get this agreement, if it's accepted by our members, well, then there will be opportunities for us to have a look at. And I'm going to talk about that in a second. So on the outsourcing protections, the use or the commitment to the use of direct labour to the greatest possible extent in the provision of public services is reaffirmed within this agreement. The commitment that the total cost of labour must be excluded from any cost comparator or in any cost comparator with a private sector provider, that is also maintained. That is the provision the government wanted to remove from the outsourcing protections. It, interestingly, without doubt, is the biggest piece of the agreement that is in our favour, because it protects us. It protects public servants from being compared to some of the lowest cost operators, non-union operators, paying minimum wage or barely just above it or so on in the private sector. The agreement also commits the sectoral employers to agree with unions the development of a service plan. And this is where we think we're going to be able to do a bit of work and start to challenge the sectoral employers on the concept of insourcing. Because if they're going to use direct labour to the greatest possible extent, well, then they're going to have to start recruiting and taking in direct employees. And the agreement on the outsourcing protections also require that there must be prior consultation with unions and their representatives before any decision is taken to outsource a service. Okay, I just wanted just to go through this slide briefly. This shows the impact of pay and those pay measures at the different stages as we go through it. I'm going to start on the column with 35,000. So if we look at the red line going across the top, and if we just have a look at that figure of 35,000, and we're going to take that down just to the end, just so that people can have a sense of it. Lots of our members would be in around that. There would be some who'd earn above it. There would be some who'd earn below it. But I just want to concentrate on this one just for the purpose of this exercise. So on the 1st of January, 2024, someone who's on 35,000, they're due to get 2.25% or 1,125, whichever is the greater. The greater figure is 1,125. So with effect from the 1st of January, their pay goes to 36,125. On the 1st of June, they'll receive a 1% increase, which is an additional €361. On the 1st of October 24, they will receive 1% or 500, whichever is the greater. Again, the 500 value is greater, so that will bring their salary with effect from the 1st of October to 36,986. With effect from the 1st of March 25, they will receive 2% or €1,000, whichever is the greater. Again, the €1,000 is greater than the 2%, so that brings their pay up to 37,986. On the 1st of October 25, they will receive a 1% increase, which is €380, which will bring them up to 38,366. On the 4th of September, they will receive the 1% local bargaining. That will bring them an additional 383, which will be up to 38,749. With effect from the 1st of February of 2026, they will receive 1% or €500. And again, here, the €500 was greater than the 1% award. So that would bring them up to €39,249. And then with effect from the 1st of June of 2026, they will receive €392, which will bring them up to €39,361. And so when you look at the cumulative impact of those pay increases with the higher amounts than what the minimum percentage payments, we can see that the total percentage value of what's contained in these proposals to someone who earns 35,000, it is actually 13.4%. So while the agreement talks about 10.25%, which is the minimum, when we apply the measures for low to middle income earners, we can see that it is significantly weighted in favour of the lower paid. So when you look just right along then just the bottom line, so if you're on 25,000 or thereabouts, it's 16.8%. If you're on 30,000, it's 14.7%. 35,000, as we said, 13.4. The 40,000, 12.9%. And then on 45,000, it comes in at 11.3%. And then it tapers away. And when you get to the 50,000 mark or above 50,000, that's when the increase becomes worth 10.25%. So just to mention, because it's important that we have an understanding as to what some of the economics and some of the finances around this agreement are. Because it's a costly agreement. And the Department of Public Expenditure and Reform, whose very reason to exist is to control public service pay, to control public service spending. And when they come to talk about public service pay, they talk about there being two ways in which they can control that spending. One being the rate of pay that public servants get, and one being the amount of public servants that are employed who are getting those pay rates. So the total cost of this agreement is 3.6 billion euro. It's actually significantly above that, because what that 3.6 billion euro doesn't take into account is the impact of those pay increases on people's overtime rates, on their shift pay, and on the allowances, where the allowances are pensionable or where the allowances are linked as a percentage of pay. So it's actually significantly north of 3.6 billion. The total cost of public service pay is 25.9 billion. Again, on the same basis that going forward, it will be significantly greater than that because of the impact, as I've said, on pay, shift, allowances, and so on. And what's interesting to note is that that 25.9 billion represents a 50% increase in public service pay since 2016. Now, not all of that pay since 2016 are pay increases, because as we do know, during the period of 2017, 2018, we were about trying to restore back that which had been taken from us in the austerity years. But you are dealing here with what the government figures and what they'll be saying out to the media and what they'll be feeding out and so on. Just in terms then of what's happening on employment, total public sector employment by the end of the year will be north of 400,000. It currently stands at about 385,000 whole-time equivalents. That's going to increase by 15,000 over the course of the year. That represents a 75,600 increase since 2016. So from the deeper point of view, this agreement being concluded is counterintuitive to them. They're trying to control these issues. And obviously from the union's point of view, we're trying to increase the numbers, and we're also trying to increase the rates of pay that public servants achieve. Just some of the inflation government forecast figures. Now, obviously around some of these figures, we've had our own economic person, Michael Taft and so on, have a look at these and so on. And largely they're forecast figures. So assuming that there's no further economic shocks or there's no significant international developments or any further, you know, serious consequences because of any of the disruption or wars that are taking place across the world, it is anticipated that in 2024, inflation is going to come in at 2.9%. In 2025, it's anticipated it's going to come in at about 2.4%. And for the first 6 months of 2026, up until the end of June, when the agreement expires, it's going to be a 0.95%, 0.95%. Now, just to make our colleagues aware that the agreement does provide for that in the event that any of the assumptions which underpin this agreement, if they were to change significantly, then we can look for the agreement to be reviewed. And the last time we would have done that successfully in any way was back in the mid to August of 2022. And over the period of about 2024 to 2030, we are entering into a period of lower economic growth, both domestically and internationally. That's anticipated that that's going to return to 2% is about a flat level. If you're less than 2%, arguably, you know, you're not too far away from, you know, people starting to talk about things like recession and so on. But we're not there, but certainly projected economic growth is going to flatten. That's just important for us to be aware, because that does impact exchequer revenues. So we just need to, because these are the key things that drive the government side and drive the Department of Public Expenditure when they come to a negotiation of this kind. So I mentioned earlier on that we would look at pay and that we would look at pay and inflation over, you know, a kind of short kind of period. So looking at it from, say, what happened in between the start of building momentum, which was the 1st of January of 2021, out to, say, the end of this agreement, which will be June of 2026. And the reason why I'm doing that and why we spoke about this at the executive, because back in January of 2021, we were at low inflation figures. Inflation began to rise in 2021, and it really took off with the energy crisis, the war in the Ukraine and so on. But it was fairly flat rate in 2021. And as we come towards the middle part and towards the end of this agreement, we will hopefully see that it will continue to return to that normal level. And what happened in the years in between, as we all know, was the cost of living and inflationary crisis. And it's just to try and get a sense of what happened with public service pay in that kind of time frame. So again, looking at, say, the colleague, the public servant, who maybe on the 1st of January 2021 earned €35,000. By the time this agreement concludes on the 30th of June 2026, that colleague, that member's salary will have increased by €8,731, which is a 24.9% increase. And you can see then what it means at the other 5,000 intervals that we've used for the example. So that's what's happened on pay within that period. How does that figure on pay then compare with what happened with inflation within the same period? So again, let's look at the colleague, the public servant, earning on 35,000. As we said, their pay increased by 24.9%. Inflation within that period was running at 23.9%, which means that within that time frame, that public servant will have received a real pay increase of in or around 1%. So these are the kind of figures that we're talking about. When you look at it for people who earned less than 35, you can see the real pay increases are worth more than that. And when you go on the 40,000 plus, we can still see that the inflation, high cost of living piece is having an effect. And that's one of the reasons why, you know, we were so anxious to ensure that we held on to the review clause, that if we did see further spikes in inflation or further issues around cost of living and so on, well, then we would be able to, you know, go back in and to invoke that clause. So the last slide just shows two tables. So it shows what happened with the two agreements as standalone agreements. So again, looking at the person on 35,000 on the 1st of January 2021, their pay increase up until the end of December 2023 was 11.2%. Inflation was running at 16.5%. So we know for that individual that there was a shortfall in wages over inflation of 5.3%. So we can see the hurt of inflation that really took place in the period 2021 to 2023. So the person who earned 25,000, it was 3.2%. And the person on 45,000 at 6.4%. So you can see within that time frame, the cost of living crisis really impacting on workers. When we look at this agreement and we look at it going forward, so the person who was on 35,000 in the 4th of January 2021 is in this year, coming into this year, now earning on the 4th of January, 38,929. The percentage increases for that worker under this agreement are 12.3%. Inflation within the period out to the end of June is anticipated to be 6.4%. And for that worker, that will mean in between now and the conclusion of this agreement, if the proposals are accepted, they will see real wage growth of 5.9%. And for the lower paid public servants, for someone who was on 25,000 coming in this year, they were on 28,318, they will see real wage growth of 9%. And when you look down to the 45,000, you can see real wage growth of 4.3%. And that tapers down the higher up the public service pay scales that you go. So as Aideen has said, there's going to be a lot of consultations. Some of it has commenced at divisional committee level and sector committee level. And I know that the colleagues, the divisional organisers and the sector organisers are giving all of our shop stewards and you know, all of our activists all of this detailed information in relation to this. And some of it we're making sector and divisional specific. As I said to you, what I've gone through today is the presentation as we would have given it by and large to the executive committee last week. Okay, I want to, if I can, maybe just by before I go to the last slide, just to. So one of the things that has become very, very clear to us in, you know, over the last couple of years, and I would have said this before, and for those of you who attend the AGMs and for those who attend the conference, you will have heard that I have expressed the view that our capacity to be able to conclude a public service agreement, the kind of one that we want, is becoming more and more difficult. And the reality of that is that because the government side don't treat either the union side or the members of the union side as equals. They view us as a stakeholder group. So when we say we want to talk about develop the public service or grow the public service, they resist that hugely. So one of the things that we've been trying to do over the last couple of weeks, we tried to do it a lot, but over the last couple of weeks, whilst the talks were going on and over the next couple of weeks, while these ballots are going on, it is vitally important that we take the opportunity to build our union in your employments. There are quite a number of public servants who are not members of a trade union who freeload on the back of those people who are members of a union. We know from experience, undoubtedly, that ballots are a great time to sign up new members, pay talks, ballots and so on. It's a good time. We do know, again, from our own experience as an organising union, that members signing up members is the best method to be able to do that. And we do need you as colleagues in your, you know, in your employments to be talking about the agreement where you can, to explain the agreement, to try to bring people the, you know, give them the access to what's contained in the agreement. Because the stronger we build our union in your employment, the stronger we're able to do, the more we're able to do better agreements. It also means that the agreement is likely to be implemented more effectively in your union. This agreement refers to it being an agreement for unions and the members of those unions. That's a clause that's contained within this agreement. So what that means is that your colleagues who aren't in the union, they can't deal with any issues that arise from the agreement. They won't be part of any conversations around the local bargaining or how the local bargaining pieces are settled. and they have no influence and so on. So we are encouraging everybody that's on the call today, as Aideen said, it's 500 people, which is great, to work with us in relation to see how we can all work together to build a union in your workplace. And there are colleagues from strategic organising who are joining us on the call today. They work with us extensively. Their assistance is always great and welcome. And we are going to be continue that follow through with you. My last slide then is just to say that the National Executive Council met last week, and following a lengthy debate on it, the executive decided that they would recommend the proposals to our members that they be accepted. The executive took the view, and it was presented to them by myself as one of the lead negotiators to the agreement, as it was the best that we could achieve in the circumstances. It was hard won, to say the least. That's the NEC recommendation. Ultimately, it will be decided by our 60,000 or so public service members. So we have commenced the consultation. The SIPTU ballot period commences on Monday, the 12th of February, and it will conclude on the 20th of March. There won't be any ballots on the 12th. There likely won't be any ballots until the end part of next week. But consultations will continue, and we wanted to make sure that we gave ourselves a real good opportunity to give everybody the opportunity to vote. The SIPTU count is going to be on Thursday, the 24th of March. And the Public Services Committee meeting, which will be all of the public service unions coming together to see how we all got on with our ballots and so on, is scheduled to take place on the 25th of March. And as I said, if these proposals are accepted, we will be going about pursuing their immediate implementation by the government side. And that will mean pursuing the retrospective element to the pay increases that are due from the 1st of January.
Thanks for that, John. That was a very comprehensive presentation, and actually addresses a number of the questions that we've already gotten in, particularly when you look at how the proposals stack up when compared to inflation, how the proposals impact low and middle income earners, as well as the local bargaining clause. So thanks very much for that. We're now quickly going to move on to Karen O'Loughlin. Karen is the divisional organiser for SIPTU's Public Administration and Community Division, and she's now going to give us an overview of how the proposals will impact on her members. Thanks, Karen.
Thanks, Aideen. I am pretty conscious of the time now, and I want to make sure that we leave enough time at the end for people to ask the questions that they want to ask, or to get, so we get the questions answered. So I'm going to be brief, and just draw your attention to a few things that will impact in the public admin and community division specifically. So I suppose firstly, and John has mentioned it already, the commitments around the outsourcing piece are really important in our division. It cuts right across education, local authorities and the state related sector. And it's a growing problem for us. So it's really useful that we have these commitments. We've had this internal discussion already. So we are going to roll out now for our officials and then for our activists, very specific training around the coordination of our efforts around outsourcing, insourcing, and the service development plans as well, so that we can get a divisionally coordinated approach on that. So that's going to be really useful for us. There are a couple of other things as well specific to our division. It's useful to see that what's referred to as the FISNUG, which is the body for the full-time and retained fire services, is now enshrined in this agreement as well. Notwithstanding some recent difficulties that we had, this is up and running again now and will reconvene on the 19th of February under the chairmanship of Kevin Duffy. Also in the proposals is the commitment to resolve the remaining outstanding issue for the retained service around their retainer. And that's really useful. And we, you know, we're going to start that process of engagement as soon as we can. Also, the proposals give us the opportunity to resolve the job profiling exercises in Waterways Ireland, the long-standing issues in the Tyndall Institute in the education sector. And there's also a reference to a piece around job evaluation that will be really good for us in the fullness of time, not immediately, but in the fullness of time. This will be very useful for us. And I'm not forgetting our members in the community sector. While the community sector obviously are not public servants, there's a very strong link between the terms of public sector agreements, which we chase for the community sector, and the recent agreements that we did in 2022, right across the different parts of the community sector that will be linked in to this public service agreement if it becomes an agreed document. So that gives a line of sight on future pay for workers in the community center or sector, specifically because of the agreements that we did last year. So that's very valuable from our point of view as well. So I am going to leave it there because, as I said, I'm conscious of time. I don't want to be talking for too long. There are a couple of sector specific issues that come up. And we'll deal with those through the sector committees over the next number of weeks. And again, if people have ongoing questions after the webinar, they can send them directly to the officials, to the sector organisers, or to the specific Ask a Question Here link that we've already circulated. So thank you for listening.
Many thanks for that contribution, Karen, particularly the piece around outsourcing. I know it was a big issue for our members in the run-up to the negotiations. I'm now going to move on to Kevin Figgis. Kevin is the divisional organiser for SIPTU's health division, and he'll just speak on the parts of the proposals that pertain to his division. Thanks, Kevin.
Thanks, Aideen. So it's great to have the opportunity to speak to everybody. Obviously, John has gone fairly extensively there into the value of the proposals for the cash point of view, and I suppose the road that we've travelled over the last couple of years. I think what's really important, and the piece I want to concentrate on in relation to health, is actually that very specific protection where it comes to outsourcing. So the reason I just want to talk about it when it comes to health is because for the health workers that are on the webinar, I presume, you know, people will be acutely aware that the health service is going through it's beginning now to go through a fairly major transition. It has probably never been as important since the foundation of the HSE in 2005 to have the protections that this agreement provides. And the reason for that is because in 2005, they created the structure from the old health boards, which they called the Health Service Executive. It was ultimately a mountain, and the very, very top of the mountain controlled everything below it. But the reality is that they're now going to move into these regional health areas. There's going to be six of them. They recently appointed within the last 2 weeks the REOs, the Regional Executive Officers, who will be individuals that will be appointed on salaries of €250,000 and will report directly to the CEO. And those REOs will ultimately be required to make decisions for their geographical area. They will have autonomy, they will have decision-making prowess, and they will have their own budget. So it's absolutely crucial for us that we maintain protections where we ensure that our members' jobs are not put on the firing line of the options that they consider as the restructuring takes place over the next number of years. As I said, the REOs have been appointed in the last 2 weeks, and we know that currently they're now trying to dismantle the national management system that they have, which they call the centre, and that will then give effect to this regional management structure that they're seeking to implement. So it's very important to us that we are able to protect, that we ensure that when they're considering the options available to them, that our members' jobs and the outsourcing of our members' jobs are not available. The other thing I think that's important as well is the emergence of artificial intelligence. And we've already seen examples in the health service where artificial intelligence is becoming more and more to the fore. We've seen it where in diagnostics, we've seen it in some of the other manual labors where robotics are being used. We've seen it on the clerical admin side, where ultimately artificial intelligence is able to complete tasks that would normally have been assigned to clerical admin duties, but that the computer is ultimately able to do it without any human input. So it's absolutely crucial that we use these protections to make sure that our members' jobs are protected in what is obviously going to be a greater challenge as the years roll on, as I said, with regards to artificial intelligence. I think there's also very important protections within the proposals where it talks about the commitment to implement several long-standing Labour Court recommendations that haven't been implemented. And it also talks about the commitment to finish off some national engagements in certain areas of the health service that would be very important to our own members that ultimately have been dragged out and we haven't been able to get to a conclusion. The normalisation of health services, or sorry, of industrial relations is very important to the health service. We've seen too often where DEEPER has used the powers that they had to frustrate progress. And that was evident that it wasn't just for us on the union side, but it would also be even for the Department of Health, for the HSE, just absolute frustration and bogged down with bureaucracy, etc. So the commitment in these proposals to return to normalised industrial relations, the use of the WRC, the use of the Labour Court is very welcome. Finally, just to say, obviously, as John has outlined, the balloting will begin over the next number of days and it'll officially start as of Monday. But what we're currently doing is working out a mechanism of local officials deciding where the ballots will take place in local areas, and that will be obviously informed to the shop stewards. But also there may be locations that would be done purely on a postal ballot. Where those locations are decided, that information will be given to the shop stewards, and the members in those areas won't need to do anything, because once that is agreed as a postal ballot location, all of the documentation will be sent to the members' home. And what we would encourage would be that people would use a link that is available that Aideann would be able to maybe share, that people can go and just ensure that we have the up-to-date information for them to make sure that if it is a postal ballot location, that we'll have the right address. I'll leave it there, Aideann. Thanks.
Thanks very much for that, Kevin. That's much appreciated. We did have a few additional questions come in over the course of the webinar. So hopefully now with the time we have left over, we'll get through one or two rounds of them. I'm going to address them towards the speakers in the order that they appeared on the webinar, if that's OK. So the first question that's come in, and it's come in from local authorities, but it's probably relevant to yourself, John. There was just a couple of questions coming in around the additional superannuation contribution, or the ASE, and what, if any, negotiations took place on that, or is that still remaining in place? Thanks.
Okay, so there were no negotiations in relation to any pension-related matters during the talks. We did receive the commitment from the government that for pre-2013 public servants in retirement, that they would maintain the link with pay. But there are no proposed changes to the additional superannuation charge. And I do know that this is an issue that comes up with every public service agreement. And I certainly that I do know that it's something that the people in our local authority sector, and in fairness, other sectors feel very strongly about. There is a reason as to why there are protections around it. Rather than take up the time to do today, what I will commit to do is to ensuring that at any of the AGMs that are coming up over the next couple of weeks, that if people want to put this on the agenda for those AGMs, I can attend and we can deal with it in that format. because it is worthy of a detailed conversation because of the, you know, the bigger things around it. But there's nothing in this agreement in relation to it.
Thanks very much for that, John. The next question now I'm going to direct towards Karen. It's a question that's come in from the education sector. Can I ask, do we know if there were any discussions around restoration of flexi time schemes and flexi leave while availing of a blended working arrangement in the workplace? And that's come in from the education sector. Thanks, Karen.
Okay, thanks, Aidan. Yes, there were some discussions around the blended working element, but the impact of blended working on flexi time wasn't part of the specific discussion, but certainly will be part of the work and activity of the sector. So that's something that I'll feed back into the sector committee as a sector specific issue to be highlighted. If the proposals become an agreement, then we can focus on that to work through it to make sure we get the proper balance into that.
Thanks for that, Karen. Much appreciated. I think the message is there that there's always going to be things that we have to deal with on an ongoing basis through our sector committees, even should these proposals pass. The next question I'm just going to direct to Kevin. We've had a couple of questions in from members in the National Ambulance Service, just wanting to know what exactly the proposals do to progress the issues of the roles and responsibilities report. And they've specifically asked the question in relation to funding and timeframe for the implementation of that report, if that's included in the proposals. Thanks, Kevin.
So the proposals set out a written commitment for the parties to engage and to conclude the roles and responsibilities review. So it is a stated written commitment in the proposals, which is wasn't easily achieved, and I think a lot of credit needs to go particularly to John in relation to securing that. So there is that written commitment in it that we will obviously be seeking to ensure that that is honoured. In relation to timelines, the reality is that there's still work to do on this. It's not concluded. There were proposals that were put to a ballot of our members that were not accepted. So we do have to revisit those matters with the employer. But the key piece for us is that I think the practice that had been the place in the previous years, where particularly the Department of Public Expenditure Reform would frustrate negotiations, would frustrate the parties being able to willingly engage. I think with the normalisation of industrial relations that we discussed earlier, plus the stated commitment that both sides would work to conclude the roles and responsibilities review as timely as possible, I think is very helpful to providing the necessary platform to both sides re-engaging and getting that work done, because obviously we have to revisit that back with our members, given the fact of the first ballot that took place.
Thanks. Many thanks for that, Kevin. I think we'll try and take one more round, if that's OK, before we finish up. Just to say to members, if we don't address your question today, as we've said, we will try and get back to you directly on anything we haven't managed to answer as part of this webinar. So I'm going to direct the next question back to John. I know you addressed this in your overall presentation, but there's been a couple of queries just in relation to local bargaining as to perhaps you could go over it again. Just specifically what the criteria are and who will actually get access to this additional 1% on the September 2025. Thanks, John.
Okay, so thanks, Aileen. And look, I mean, so this is new, this local bargaining piece in there's going to be loads of people on the employer side. There's going to be loads of sectoral employers that have never dealt with a local bargaining clause before. because everybody was always tightly constrained to only getting the minimum provisions, and there was a strict no cost increase in claims beyond that. The first thing to say is it's not like the sectoral bargaining fund that existed under Building Momentum. That was a 1% pay increase, or sorry, a 1% pot of money that could be used to settle some outstanding issues, or where there wasn't some issues to be resolved, it could be paid as a general pay round, and there were some kind of variations in between. So in other words, if settling an issue only used half the money, well, then the other half could go for the general pay round. It's not like that. The local bargaining clause is future related around unions serving claims on behalf of their members for an increase up to the value of 3%. It's up to the unions, it's up to the sectors to be able to do that on behalf of all of their members in all of their grades. Some grades will be one union only. Some grades will go across a number of unions, and they'll go across a number of sectors. And all of that detail will be teased out in between now and the end of June. So, for instance, the retained firefighters are SIPTU members, and they'll be a grade upon which we'll pursue a claim for 3%. The National Ambulance Service paramedics, the SIPTU members, there are some in Unite and so on, they're part of the IARC group. So the IARC group will pursue a claim for 3% on behalf of its members in the ambulance service. People in universities, so where there are distinct grades groups and categories, it's there to be to allow a claim to be lodged. The management might want some change, and that'll have to be negotiated, but it's capped at a value of 3%. Of that 3%, 1% is due to be paid on the 1st of September 2025. The other 2% will fall to be paid after June of 2026. So that's why I said that in between June of this year and June of next year, negotiations will start to take place at the level of sectoral employers on these claims. And it's going to be new. It's going to enable us to have general meetings to try to organise workers to be able to do a bit of agitation about talking about pursuing. It's giving people the opportunity to be able to deal with some of their own issues, some of their own grievances in the workplace. So, you know, over the next couple of weeks and months, if the proposals are accepted, we'll get a lot more familiar with what it is we're trying to do here.
Many thanks for that, John. I'm conscious of the time, but I do want to allow Karen and Kevin to come back in on a couple of questions, if that's okay. So if I could just ask them to be as brief as possible, that would be great. Just directed towards Karen, there was a query that came in from local authorities basically asking, what do the proposals say about the reform agenda? I work in a local authority and feel we're being asked to engage with a lot of change at the moment.
Okay, so the proposal doesn't say anything new in relation to the reform agenda. It commits the parties to complete the commitments that were given in previous proposals, but there's nothing specifically new for the local authorities. Now, there will be a piece when we engage in the 3% local bargaining, where the employer may look for some exchange for that. But I mean, that's to be negotiated, and obviously will have to be negotiated to the satisfaction of the members involved. But there's nothing specifically different in this proposal that's not already contained in previous proposals.
Many thanks for that, Karen. That was a very succinct answer to that one. Can I also just direct now the final question to Kevin Figgis of the Health Division? A question's come in from a Section 38 location. What can I do if my employer doesn't implement the agreement locally, or what can we do as a union?
Well, I would imagine that we would be very closely involved in the implementation of these proposals if they are agreed in all locations. What is important to say is Section 38 employment is a fully funded public service. The employees are public servants. So they may not work for the HSE, but they are. It is fully funded and they are public servants. So we have had difficulties in the past where it was actually more so on the HSE side, by the way, than the Section 38s. But we have had difficulties in the past where they have not necessarily paid as soon as we would have liked. But I think there was great effort has been made over the last 2 or 3 years to really try to get them to knuckle down and to pay them much more timely. So I think that if there was any issues, I think that it would obviously be appropriate that would be reported to the local officials and that we would then be engaging with the local Section 38. But we'd also be engaging with the HSE with the view of making sure that any barriers that were in the way were removed. But I would not see there being a general difficulty in Section 38 applying the agreement if these proposals are accepted, given the fact that they are fully funded and the staff are public servants.
That's great. Thanks very much for that, Kevin. Look, that brings to conclusion the webinar this afternoon. I'll just finish briefly by saying thanks very much for giving up your Friday afternoon to join us and get a bit of clarity on the proposals. And also just to say that if we didn't get to answer any of your questions today, we will be responding to you directly. Thanks very much.